Hello and welcome to Simply inTAXicating. The GST is little more than 6 weeks old and the trade industry is almost settled. But the issue is now the entire economy, the entire trade industry is gearing up to file the return. But the larger issue is the credit. That is something which is creating trouble, concern for the industry, where they feel that huge magnitude of working capital is going to get stuck. For that, we have four distinguished experts today. We are going to discuss about that aspect. We will also touch the GST Council at its last meeting. The 20th meeting has already approved the EVA bill rules and also the rules relating to anti-profiteering. The GST Council also decided to hike the sales for automobiles from 15% to 25%. That is to be notified later after the Act is amended. In fact, the Chief Economic Advisor, Mr. Arvind Subramaniam, has come out with a second volume of economic survey where he has also touched upon GST in a big way, where he is talking about that GST is certainly a system substantially improved to the system which we had prior to July 1st. He also talks about the GST ambit should be expanded and more sectors of the economy like electricity, real estate should be roped in quickly. We have four distinguished experts. We have Mr. T R Rustagi, the former Joint Secretary and the Chief Commissioner of Central CBEC. We have Mr. Pratik Jain, National Head, PwC, and also our knowledge partner. We have Mr. Sanjeev Srivastava, the Commissioner and a member of the Law Committee, GST. And we have Mr. Singh, Senior Vice President, GST Network. So, let me start with Mr. Sanjeev Srivastava. Presently, the concern of the industry is the credit, ITC. So, what has been done? I heard that the government is, or the, maybe the Law Committee had decided to extend it by a week or so. So, what is the element of truth in this?
See, the concern is for the credit. The credit is not going to go anywhere. Only the question is whether the credit can be given in this month at the time of filing the 3B. Now, we are discussing on that, and one thing is a person who has to pay the tax, he comes up and pays the tax at least on the 20th. On that day, if he pays the tax, then there can be some extension proposed for filing of 3B, and before that, Tran 1 should be made available by GSTN so that it is filed and the credit comes. So, that may be a possible solution which is being looked into.
Yeah, and in fact, last time in the last episode, Mr. Judy Luhani also said that that you know the government is already deliberating and a decision is going to be taken. So we are very close to that now. So the decision is about to be notified.
Decision will be taken finally and notified. But let us see what finally in what form it comes. The question is you have to look into on what date Trans 1 can be made available exactly by GSTN. And after filling the Trans 1, you give some time. But as a trade and industry, I know what exactly is my credit that is to be transmitted. I know what is the credit which will be available to me. So, first of all, if I have to talk about, let a calculation. If I intend to avail the credit in my 3B or at this point of time, I should have a tax value. I should have what will be my credit. And on the basis of that, if I calculate what is my next tax liability which I have to pay in cash and I pay, then there can be
The facility may follow.
The second thing is there can be another person who is not intending to file Tran 1 in this month itself. Might be in that case, there is no question of credit flowing into him.
Okay.
So, if he is not even intending, because Tran 1 can be filed within 90 days, it is provided in law. I may say that I wanted to file Tran 1 in the month of September. So, if I have to file Tran 1 in the month of September, so, in any way, I was not claiming any credit during this month, during the return 3B when I had to file.
Okay.
So, such a facility cannot be extended to that person.
So, let me go to Pratik, who could articulate the concern in the industry in a better way, because he is also indicating that if there is going to be an extension, there would be certain conditions.
But one point in principle I am just asking, is it a failure of thinking that you are thinking of an extension at this stage? I mean, did not you...
visualize
did not you see this earlier that on 20th they have to pay the tax. So the credit should also be available by that date.
Sir,
so how is it where it is failing?
There is no failure of thinking, because the principle was Tran 1 will be available, it could be filed. If Tran 1 was filed, say, on 10th, if somebody have filed Tran 1 on 10th, he gets the credit. The problem is because we have to get system ready also for implementation of this law. System readiness is also having a game, is having a serious concern. If suppose Tran 1 was made available on the 1st of July itself, might be 90% of people would have filed by now. Credit would have automatically flowed. If GST R1 could have been made available on that day. So, we have to get system ready also. System
so
has to be in place.
Our system is not in place.
No, it is system is in place. System, yes. We are not denying system is not in place. System has to be in place.
But system is not functional. Okay. System is
I
not
think
fully
some, somewhere we have, but I agree with sir when he says that perhaps there was a, it was the reaction came late, because this whole 3B issue was highlighted to the government long back. I mean, at least a month back we highlighted, it was reported in media.
Yeah,
it
was
CBC.
Officially decided.
There was a Twitter clarification which came in, unfortunately, which said that it will be allowed. Then another Twitter clarification came saying it will not be allowed.
Right.
Fundamental point is that earlier GSTR 1 had to be filed for the first month by 10th of August. It got extended because system was not ready. And obviously, I mean, such a huge system, it could take time. By 20th, you had to file the first subsidy return. Obviously, it will be unfair for anyone to assume that businesses will not get the opening credit. The procedural aspect can't deny the substantive right of a business to say, if something is there in my books on 30th of June as a credit, how can you deny me the payment? I mean, there are hundreds of crores which are at stake, right? So, I think perhaps, the decision was delayed. But if the decision comes in this manner, to say that Trans 1 you file now and after a week you file 3B, I think the problem will be solved. The only addition or request that we will have from industry side is, please allow us to amend the Trans 1, because there could be a situation where I am not able to file the Trans 1 in full detail, I may not have enough details, and I will only file the opening credit which I have, which are in books, and I don't know how much credit do I have in, let's say, July for that matter. So allow us to file a Trans 1, and tomorrow if there is a change, please allow us to amend it. That's the only request that we
have. See, as I see it, it is very crucial. This ITC is very crucial in the sense that you have made a major change. Earlier, you are giving the credit moment the goods are received, even if the duty was not paid. Now, you have made a condition that I will give you the credit only when the payment has been done. So, it is a major change you are making in policy. When you are making such a major change, why don't you anticipate all the problems of it? That if you are saying that the return will be filed by 10th, return will be filed by 20th, then how is it on the D-day you say that we are considering extension? I mean, it does not speak well of the policy making. You should have been fully prepared for it. You should have been fully prepared that there is no case of any extension. We'll give you credit by this date. Otherwise, it gives a very wrong signal to the trade and industry. So, if that kind of signal goes to the trade and industry, then the credibility of the entire reform you are talking, that gets diluted to some extent. People will disbelieve you, that you never know. I mean, they may say something, but tomorrow it is not going to really implement it that way. That is the issue, real issue behind it. So, that is the worry.
I think, sir, actually, they have been, for the government, the GST network has been a big challenge. So, we have to give them credit also, but at the same time, they want to go a little slow because they don't want to burden the GST network with too many forms, too much of load. So, I think because there is a third party vendor involved in the whole exercise. So what is the status now? I mean, Mr. Singh will perhaps tell us a little more about this.
See, the whole exercise that we are going through, this GST is a very complex exercise. I mean, so many governments are involved, so many laws are involved, and so many types of, in this transition also, there are different types of credits which are involved because of the fact that different laws are getting merged, subsumed, and you have one GST. Because government, I think what we realized, that government was thinking of two aspects, that it should not be complex either, and it should be fairly simple and also comprehensive, because industry was coming up with different scenarios in which the credit could be locked, and they wanted this credit to be transferred to the GST regime. I think mid-June when the form was finalized and we finalized the software requirement specification, and it has been given to the Infosys who is developing the software. But they are developing it and they are committed to releasing it very soon. But I think we should realize that this is a complex exercise and the whole model is new. Now what we are having is that people will take credit through trans 1 or 2, and right from the beginning the deadline for trans 1 was 90 days. So it was envisaged that people won't be taking credit in the first return itself. Okay. Because so GSTR 1, even if it had not been relaxed, would have been filed by 1 and 2 by 15, by 10th and 2 by 15th of August.
Okay.
So this was the scenario, and I think there is a history to it that the first, I mean, anything which has happened in the past is when VAT transitions took place, there was a transitional credit which was made available to the taxpayers in the VAT regime. But that process was that people got transitional credit after 6 months.
Okay.
And that too in installments, because suddenly if you give the transitional credits, the cash flow, the revenues will fall dramatically. So government at that time took that route. And maybe that was at the back of the mind. Here also people were committed to giving the credit very early.
So one solution, Pratik is suggesting that the government should allow the industry to revise this trans one. I mean, maybe this feedback is...
The question is always this thing, ki why if I am intending, I am saying I have to get a credit. And if I am myself not in position to determine that credit in this month, was I in position to file it this month? The question is ki we are putting a blame on government or on GSTN, but I say ki I myself could not have determined what could have been my credit. Trans 1 requires a lot of information to be filled in. The thing was, Trans 1 was to be filed within 90 days after determination, and I get the credit whether GST R3B or GST R3 only once Trans 1 was filed. You are filing first GST R3 on the, suppose there was no change, it was, everything would have been smooth, would have been filed on 20th. You would have got the credit, opening balance of the credit from Trans 1. There is no change in that. You are allowed not to file Trans 1 and claim the credit in the next month or claim it after that, third month also. There is no question. What he was telling is this thing, specifically, we put this thing, I want the credit, but I don't know what my credit is on 20th.
First of all, we
should understand one thing. I am claiming certain credit as a matter of right. And if I am claiming credit as a matter of right, what is, I know what is the extent of my right. What is my extent of right? I file that transfer. Now, I say I am not ready to file, but government has not made available the form. What GSTN or... Why should I say form is not available? You are not ready. If you are not ready, where is the question of any credit?
No, so there are three things in transfer, if I understand correctly. One is your closing credit as on 30th June, whether it could be a service tax credit or a VAT credit, which was there in my return.
Right.
There is no absolutely no issue in terms of determining it. Okay, so that's there. But also we have to understand that closing credit for this service tax, 30th June, there is the last day of 15th of August.
Right.
That return can also be revised later.
Right.
We have 90 days. So, there could be a situation where my credit number could change because I am genuinely revising it as per the law.
Right.
So, what the credit of 100, which I am claiming now on 30th June, it could become 110 tomorrow. Right? That's one problem, sir. The second is, in trans 1, I also have to take the actual retailers, etc. I have to take actual credit of excise duty paid, etc.
Right.
So, that's the third, second one. Third is, I'll have to take the credit for the month of July. Right? These are the three things that also
goods will, received in the month of July.
Goods, yes, received in the month of July. That also has to be, now that July month, you know, so sometimes could take time for me to ascertain. My IT systems are not ready in many cases, etc., etc. Right now, my concern is that at least the opening credit, which was there on 30th June, that I should get, you know,
which is already determined.
This is already determined. Now, if I file that in trans 1 and I'm not able to determine, let's say for July, and bear in mind that we don't have the GSTR as in the trans 1 functionality as yet. So when you say 90 days was the given the time and industry could have filed it on 5th of July or 10th of July, there was no form available.
The one thing I find a bit discomforting is, how is it that people are having so much of huge credit? Because normally, if normal course of business, you will end up having your output supplies at a higher price than your input. So this accumulation of credit should not have been there.
Oh, huge credit, sir. There are industries.
A few cases there might be.
There are cases of exports, okay, where I have credit.
Exports,
in my books.
They can take refund in the.
But I have domestic liability also, so there is a credit in my books. There were sectors like auto and all that, and I know of companies who have 400, 500 crores of credit in the books because they had inverted duty structure. They were importing where they were paying SAD and CVD, CVD both. On the output, there was only excise duty. So there have been cases.
There are a few cases where there is a significant amount of money involved, and that's why. But there won't be much. The number of cases would be few.
And also
there are
a
few with powerful, significant amount of credit involved. In case of auto, I have heard many people have
and
said.
And also, sir, for the retailer and traders, they are also going to get excise duty credit for the stock in hand, which was not there earlier. So that for the first time that moves to transfer.
Yes. No, I mean, their concern is largely that their working capital will take a hit. You know, if the credit is not available, that means everything has to be paid in cash.
But in principle, we agree that it ought to have been given.
Credit is available. Nobody is denying the question of credit.
So, we will move to next topic. Yes. I mean, they are making efforts, sir. There has been little delay. But let's give them credit and
interest na lagega to people will be.
But delay is
let's
cost
also
to the
motivate deal. Them sir, to do it fast.
Delay is cost to the industry.
Yes, delay is cost to the even for them also, sir. I mean
the question is if people are not paying tax on 20th, it is a cost to the department also.
But the issue is that as a matter, as a principle or as a policy maker, if you announce a policy, then you should implement that policy that way. Why should you go on the defense? That no, I did not do, but still I have an argument that it need not have been done.
Yes, sir. It is central, sir.
Very central.
Yes, sir. The another issue which is becoming central is the anti-profiteering, where I would like Pratik to articulate the concern and Mr. Sanjeev.
So, I think on anti-profiteering, let me start by saying that as far as the intent is concerned, there is absolutely no question. The issue is that while you have the process, the way anti-profiteering has to work is there, screening committee, you know, standing committee and authority, etc. What we don't have, and we were expecting that to happen in the GST Council meeting last time, are guidelines as to how the profit or loss has to be computed. So, we were talking about that, right? So, right now, there is a lot of confusion in the industry that if I have a multi-product kind of a portfolio, do I have to follow this on each product basis?
Right.
Do I have to follow it a gross profit basis or a net profit basis? You know, costing is a very complex thing. My raw material cost could go up, my labor cost could go up, my exchange fluctuation could go up. So, there have to be guidelines. What we've also seen on ground, there are states like Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra and few others who have started issuing notices to businesses to say, what was your pre-GST price, what was your post-GST price, what was the dealer margin, retailer margin, etc. Leading to issues. The fear is that in absence of these immediate guidelines, and any guidance from the government to the state level officers or the central officers in different states not to issue these kind of notices, it could just become like a wild
fire, create chaos,
which will lead to a lot of litigation. So
Sanjeevji,
anti-profiteering as a concept is a new concept which we have brought in the GST law. It is basically saying that net of the tax, consumer should benefit, not the middleman or the person selling the goods. Now, because actual tax is being paid by the consumer, till that time anti-profiteering thing settles down, because it is a new concept, there can be certain type of disputes which are coming up. But the law strictly provides for a mechanism how to approach anti-profiteering authority. It is not that key as a department or as any this thing, somebody approaches and comes forward. It is, if I have been cheated, if I want to make
a
complaint,
as a consumer, I can make a complaint, yes.
A complaint comes, then you start an investigation in anti-profiteering body. Then their complete mechanism has been laid down through screening committee, monitoring committee, and then there is a investigating authority with the DGA safeguards, where a complete investigation, and then it comes to the anti-profiteering body. That is the entire mechanism which law itself lays down. Now, I still am not able to get it key from where anti-profiteering mechanism have set into motion, whereby notices and other things have come forward, without...
No, that is fine, market. But the ground reality is this. Yes, he is talking about the ground reality.
Coming to ground reality also. Now, as a departmental officer, somebody wants to know what is the price which have changed, GST. What is the price mechanism that is going on. Somebody might have been asking these questions, which may not be actually an anti-profiteering question. What can be the guideline for determination of anti-profiteering, whether it is there.
Right.
Now, if you look into our country, there can be thousands and thousands of business models.
Yes.
It is not that every business model will determine the, by a simple mathematical logic, A plus B plus C minus D gives me anti-profiteering. It is not a exercise which can be
done. It's a gigantic work, no doubt about it.
No, but what he's saying, I think the central government has issued instructions that no inspector should be.
Yeah, that we have issued, sir. We
have similar thing state should also do till your anti-profiteering mechanism comes into operation.
So I think, sir, even
when what he is asking about guidelines.
Correct.
So I am only saying that the anti-profiteering authority itself will determine the guidelines. How to determine the price.
Okay. That is why it has not been notified.
Yeah. So anti-profiteering.
There's a couple of points I want to add. That when anti-profiteering came in Malaysia last in 2015, it was there in Australia. Both of these countries had defined guidelines. Yes, India is much more complex as a country, and no doubt about that. Okay, but those guidelines need to be there, because otherwise what will happen is, and if you look at the anti-profiteering law also, not only the consumer, it says any person could go and file a complaint.
Hmm.
So any person could be you, me, anyone, right?
That's why the rivals, so the
once
competitors.
I, and once I file a complaint, it has to go through a process.
Yes.
Either approval, rejection, etc. Right? So companies are fearing now, what do I do? Because anybody can go and file a complaint. If I take a view that, okay, I can increase the gram from 100 to 110, somebody files a complaint, no, price has not reduced, the law says price should be reduced.
So it is just now, like
it will
RTI.
Go into a litigation.
RTI. Absolutely, sir.
So therefore, I think it's important that, and I completely agree that the detailed mathematical calculation cannot be given in the guideline,
right.
But those 10 principles, product-wise, company-wise, first quarter,
some draft rules should be made public so that people could discuss and debate.
That principles will come and the guideline property comes into
it. He's right. Let the authority first come into existence. After that, these details can be decided, because as of now, there is no structure of this.
Right,
so
sir.
Once the structure comes into place, then these things can be decided later on.
That is fine.
But I personally don't feel that there will be many cases of this type. In theory, of course, anybody will go.
But harassment is going to be many, sir. Mm-hmm. No, I mean, the harassment cases will be many.
Already
harassment,
started, yes.
As they say, that the central government has already told that no inspector should visit. Similarly, the state can also say that.
And this should be highlighted, actually.
Should highlight.
The people should be made aware, industry
so
should be made
take
aware.
Care of
the
it.
CBC has given direction to all the departmental officers not to, you know, send letters to the industry
care.
And trade like this.
Because you are giving lot of ads on GST.
Yes,
so one of the ads
like,
can be this also.
Yes, exactly. Sir.
Nobody should visit.
Probably this will help, you know, and this will reduce the number of complaints reaching CBC. So now we will move to eBay bill, because it has also been approved. And do you see much change what has been approved now and what was there in the earlier draft?
I don't think that. I think the earlier draft has been approved. I haven't seen any changes. The GST Council has said that eBay bill rules have been approved. The date has not been notified as yet. And one is hearing about October 1. I'm not sure whether GSTN will be ready by October 1 or not.
GSTN is not involved in
it. It's not involved in GSTN.
And I see. GSTN has... is giving the money to NIC.
NIC will do it.
So I think, you know, if you look at the eBay bill, the whole rules in summary is that there are two portions, Part A and Part B. Part A has to be done by the supplier who's shipping the product. Part B can be either to be done by the supplier or by the transporter. It also talks about if the vehicle, if the goods move from one vehicle to another, then the transporter has to cancel the earlier eBay bill and generate a new eBay bill.
Right.
And there are timelines that for 100 kilometers, the eBay
bill
will be for. I think there are lots of concerns which have been raised. The fundamental point which is being raised is that do we need an eBay bill now in the in the revised scheme of things, of, in the IGST regime, etc. Of course, movement of services do not have any eBay bill.
Right.
And there were few states earlier who did not have a road permit. That's the first question. But I think the decision has been taken that yes, we need an eBay bill. The second question is whether 50,000 limit is enough. Whether those things about 100 kilometers, 12, 24 hours validity, etc., those are realistic. 75-80% of our transport sector is unorganized.
Right.
Whether they will have wherewithal to generate eBay bill in case vehicle is, goods are transferred from one vehicle to another. I think those are questions which are unanswered. once e-way bill system is implemented, then we will see, you know. But I think some of these time limits, etc., definitely need to be looked at. I think industry should be given some more time before e-way bill is introduced. I don't think we need to hurry it up from October 1. We are already facing a lot of challenges in the normal right. compliances itself. And e-way bill is introduced as early as October 1, then I suspect it will impact the trade industry negatively.
But so maybe Sanjeevji, on timing, you are flexible. You are extending so many things.
Yeah, that can be extended. So but sir, what is important is the draft rule and what has been approved by the GST Council. I mean, that is not made public. What has been approved? Whether any changes have been done in the draft? Like you said, GSTN is not going to do it. Earlier proposal was the GSTN will generate e-permit, etc. Now the NIC is a new decision. So, what is there? I mean, is there something which you would like to touch upon?
E-way bill concept is not a mechanism to put any compliance burden on the trade. It is on the contrary, reducing the burden on the trade. Earlier, we have been told that by the process of movement of the goods or vehicle on every state border, truck used to go and stand for 3 days
that is
before
true.
That it could that cross. E-way bill or these mechanisms have been introduced that there is a smooth movement of goods. The first thing which was the first principle of the GST, which was you have to allow a smooth movement of the goods across the country. Now, e-way bill is one of the mechanisms by which it has been tried to be achieved. Now, if you look into what is the information required for generation of e-way bill, it is nothing. It is nothing. You have to fill only 3-4 fields. 5 fields which supplier or persons generate this. What transporter fills is the vehicle number in the part B. That is the thing. Now, if vehicle changes, what will change is only vehicle number. Vehicle number is going to change. Now, it is not that it is going to cause a very this thing. Now, what is being intended is why not e-way bill generation should be possible on an electronic mode or on your mobile. So, for that it has been kept so simple that it can be done from anywhere through a mobile or this thing you can. Secondly, earlier what was there it was prescribing time limit for validity of a e-way bill. It doesn't say that after 100 kilometers or 200 kilometers if you have not reached your consignment bill, you have to regenerate a e-way bill. That is only the thing. It is only validity in time. GST Council said that you put it in a manner that it will be for every 100 kilometers one day.
So the fundamental point is that when the transport happens, you have an invoice, tax invoice, where the supplier GST number is there, the consignee's GST number is there. At the check post or whosoever is verifying, can only verify whether they are registered or not. I mean, that's enough.
Right.
To my mind, why do we need a separate mechanism of a waybill to be generated?
Not so.
And also, while sir, you are saying absolutely and completely understand the mobile phone.
What you are talking of, a full truckload consignments. I am carrying a mixed bag of consignment. In the same this thing, I am carrying 10 type of different consignments. Some may be taxi,
so be an aggregator
some
or something.
Aggregator. In the same transport vehicle, it is not always that you are thinking in terms of I am having one consignment, one invoice. I am carrying 10 invoices, 10 different type of goods in my vehicle. What I do? I am giving you a mechanism, a simple mechanism by way where you can just pass on.
So let's make it optional in that case.
And also, sir, if there are 10 consignment, I'll have to generate 10 e-way bills also.
You can generate it, it can be put into a consolidated RFID, this thing can be taken and you can carry that. That is provided in the law. Now, once it has been provided, it is only facilitating a smooth movement of the goods.
But this threshold of 50,000 is a little low nowadays. If you look,
there was a discussion that 50,000 will move to 1 lakh. And the other problem, suppose it is even 50,000, it will move it from a supply chain perspective, people to avoid e-way bills, they will start using smaller vehicles, etc. And that will defeat the whole purpose of GST or supply chain efficiency, etc.
50,000 is one refrigerator.
One refrigerator. Sir, one TV, sir, nowadays, one television, 50,000.
The question is that has to be, if
I mean, why to start with low threshold?
And within the state,
also reduce the threshold later.
And e-way bill is also there for within the state also, except for 10 kilometers.
Right.
Earlier, road permit was only there with the borders were crossed. Now it is within the state also.
Right. So, I mean, sir, before we wind up, another very important aspect we must touch is that GST administration, sir. Maybe Pratik would like to articulate a few uses with respect to this.
I think GST overall has been smoother than what we expected in last 40 days or so. One thing, of course, is the administration part of it. We still see that as far as the state government machinery is concerned, first to start with, who is my jurisdictional officer for each GSTN? Is something which is not clear. Okay, when you go to GSTN, some officer is there mentioned in some cases not mentioned. But I am not clear with the business whether central government officer is going to audit me or state government officer. Advanced ruling authority has not been set up. GST is at nascent stage, and if any clarification I need it now. If the authority itself is set up after 6 months, then the whole purpose of advanced ruling is gone. So I think from an administration point of view. And particularly the state level, I think a lot of training and a lot of guidance still required for them to really understand the nuances of GST.
I want to ask a question.
Sir.
What is your assessment when the whole thing will settle down? Is it 6 months or 1 year or 2 years? I mean, just personal. Your personal assessment.
Sir, if we look into any tax law, it is a process of evolution. Second is tax administration. I would like to touch upon two things. Tax law keep on evolving. If you look into central excise law, it was first from 1944, it kept on evolving. State tax laws kept on evolving. Every tax law will evolve and it will take its own time. Second question is settling down of administration. If we look into the thing is, it is a preparedness on the both the sides, from the government side and from the
trade
industry side also, because all the issues which are there will keep on coming up in some form or other. And how much we are able to settle down with one thing or other thing cannot be predicted in one go. Government would like to say at the earliest. And government is, I think, working day and night for that.
But had GST Council given any direction to the states that they should notify the advance ruling quickly?
It is provided in the law.
But they have not notified, as
it
Pratik
is provided
said.
In
only
the
two
law
three
itself,
states have done it.
See, what happens is something which has been said in the law, it should be done. I cannot say that I have to give another direction that go and constitute an authority. Today, a person who wants an advance ruling, you will come to the government and say, tell me, I want an advanced ruling authority.
So, where exactly they should? They should go to GST Council.
But who has to monitor whether they are
not notified, where will I go if I am the taxpayer?
It is advanced ruling authorities are to be constituted by the state government, by the state administration. They are working upon it and they have started constituting it. Now, all these things may take some time. It may take some time.
Sometime means 6
sir,
months, 1 year,
sir,
6
I
years,
40
predict,
days
sir.
Are over,
sometime.
Sir.
I cannot predict on the availability of officers or this thing from the state side.
Right. I think the role of the GST Council in these things perhaps need to be more proactive.
Strengthened
absolutely. And you know, if you see first 1 month, you had state like Maharashtra increasing the road tax on vehicles, you have Tamil Nadu increasing the entertainment tax on,
right.
And the proposal, and I think it has been kept on hold. I think some of these things, while not strictly part of GST, GST Council should be more proactive in the sense that tell the states, let's hold on for some time.
Correct.
Let's see how it evolves.
Yes.
Let's give 3, 4, 5 months to the industry and trade.
Right.
And notify these authorities quickly, because the whole purpose of advanced ruling, etc. But we'll get lost if it's not done.
Exactly. So, anything GST Network is doing for the taxpayer, you'd like to share with the taxpayer that something you are ready and something more you are coming up with, various kinds of offline, online tools, etc. And how exactly your call center is working?
As per our mandate, we are trying our best to facilitate the compliance requirements, online compliance requirements for the taxpayers, which involved first thing what we did was enabling taxpayers to migrate to the GST regime, enabling new taxpayers to register in the GST regime, enabling them to opt for compounding both the migrated and the new registered.
Now the deadline is getting over, so it's going to be extended.
It has been extended. That facility is now available on GST portal for people to opt for compounding.
This last date is August 16th.
Ah, yes.
So it has been further extended?
That I think sir would tell.
No news. Law committee
but
has some
already
recommendations.
A significant number of people have opted for compounding. Then we have made available this GSTR1, preparation of GSTR1 on the online portal. And an offline tool, Excel-based offline tool has been made available to the industry. Further, GSPs, around 10 GSPs have already been activated and they are now connected to the system. And the other, the rest of the first batch will become, will be onboarded soon in the next, I think, a week.
Okay.
And new batch is also, the process is going on to enlist more GSPs. And then GSTR 3B is now available on the portal. It can be prepared and also I think from today it can be filed also.
Okay.
So a lot of things, and we are also conducting awareness session. A number of webinars have been conducted on GSTR 1 and filing and on 3B, on transition, on registration, composition, all these things. So we are trying to our best with the capacity, the resources we have to make the taxpayers aware and also facilitate them to do the filings and the compliances.
So on
but
this,
but it is a I won't say there are problems. There are technical glitches because it is a massive system. Around 80 lakh people are now on the system. In a few thousand cases, some technical glitches are arising with GST, which Infosys is taking care of. So people need to be patient, and in this mammoth change exercise that we have embarked on.
Okay. So on this note, let me thank all my four guests. As Mr. Singh suggests that the taxpayers need to be a little more patient. So if you are patient, you will get more tools from the GST network. And hopefully the GST network should join hands with the states to organize, apart from webinar, other kind of events for small taxpayers, which may not be that tax heavy and participating in webinars. So that area needs to be explored. But as Pratik suggested, that maybe the government and the law committee should think in terms of giving option of revising the trans one. Because naturally, there would be revision. I mean, even in income tax law and various other tax laws, the revision is something, it's one of those substantive rights for the taxpayers, because there would be some error even the taxman does it. So revenue is fine, revenue is protected, and the revenue is supposed to collect what is due to them, and the taxpayers, then they should be given the option of correcting if there are some errors, because collecting revenue out of errors, perhaps the government intention is not that. So let's hope that the as soon as the authority is notified, the applications for heading the authority have already been invited by the government, authority is notified, then of course there would be a mechanism for receiving complaints and monitoring committee, screening committee, etc. And some guidelines will also come, as rightly suggested, that the cost, determining cost, will be a big challenge. It's a challenge for the industry, it's a challenge for the revenue as well. And as Mr. Sanjeev Srivastava suggested, that the eBay bill is not to add to the burden on the industry, this is to facilitate. Let's hope that the substance takes over the form and industry really feels that it is actually facilitating. So on this note, thanking you all for watching TIOL, and also my knowledge partner PwC.